Good evening. Welcome to the September 3rd Northampton City Council meeting. I'm City Council Vice President Jesse Adams. I'll be chairing the meeting tonight. We'll start with public comment. Each member who would like to speak has up to 3 minutes to speak. If you've noticed that someone else has made the points that you have, that you would have liked to have made, if you could defer to, because the point has already been made, that'll be greatly appreciated by the council. This meeting is being recorded. The first person I have is Rabbi Rhonda Shapiro-Reeser. And if everyone could give their name as well as their address, please. Thank you.
So I'm Rabbi Rhonda Shapiro-Reeser. I live in Greenfield, but I have an office on 16th Center Street in Northampton. I just want to tell you, and I also want to thank you for the invitation to speak, and I want to thank you for the community members, your constituents, not just union members, but community members from Northampton who are here. Could you hold up your hands? People are just community members. I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm going to tell you the truth because I'm a rabbi. Not just because I'm a rabbi, because Yom Kippur is coming, and I'm not going to lie 2.5 weeks before I have to stand before God with my sins. We are not a disgruntled minority, as some people have stated. So over 60% of the staff at CSO voted against the contract. No matter how you twist statistics, there's no way that 60% of something is a minority. I know of absolutely nobody who makes the mythological $50,000 a year that therapists make. I work at CSO part-time. You know why I work at CSO part-time? I can't afford to work there full-time. I have a small private practice in Northampton. I have purposely kept it small because I believe that poor people get referred to an agency, and poor people deserve the same level of therapy that a private person comes to a private therapist for. But I don't know how long I can keep that up. CSO has not bargained in good faith. We're not making huge demands here. We are just asking CSO to bargain in good faith. When we had a plaintive cry that we can't handle productivity, and productivity, by the way, is people, that you're giving us too many people. We can't give that many people what they need. The response from management was, well, you're going to have to add two more people a month. Two more people a month is the equivalent of adding another week to our year. And by the way, if you only get paid for people you see, so if you have to see 24, 25 clients, we carry a caseload of maybe 40 to see that. We are overworked, we are underpaid. What I found in my other part-time jobs, I don't make that much more money, but I do make enough to live off of, and what I get is respect and value. I have a doctorate in spiritual direction counseling. I have a graduate certificate in autism spectrum disorders. I have a specialty and concentration in addictions therapy. And if I can't stay at CSO, that is lost. That's truth. Here's my opinion. My opinion is that CSO is more interested in breaking a union and keeping its bottom line by pushing on its staff than it is for caring for patients. We have a long waiting list. You are a beginner as a therapist for the first 5 years. Anybody will tell you that. All my professors told me that. Takes 10 years to get some fluency. The current average tenure at CSO now is a little over 3 years.
Rabbi, I'm sorry, if you could wrap it up.
It's a little over 3 years. We're talking about your children and your neighbors, and we need people who are not overworked and underpaid to be able to help them. Thank you.
Thank you, Rabbi. Denise Buckingham.
Hello, everybody. My name is Denise Buckingham, and I live on 19 Ballard Street in East Hampton. And I just wanted to talk today about some myths that I think have been thrown out there and just talk about some of the facts. As you are aware, the Business Practices of Clinical and Support Options, a taxpayer-funded nonprofit mental health agency, have been the subject of months of escalating conflict. In April, clinicians and crisis workers staged demonstrations outside agency facilities to draw attention to near-poverty wages and severe workplace stress at CSO, serious challenges that have spurred high turnover that jeopardizes the continuity and quality of client care. Despite the involvement of a federal mediator, the agency's management team has rejected all attempts to address these grave issues, ultimately leading to a 3-day strike for quality care in July. Agency managers remain unwilling to engage in any level of serious dialogue to resolve the ongoing conflict. And this document lays out the myths and facts in the fight for quality care at Clinical and Support Options, incorporating data provided by the agency's management team on July 15th, 2015. And after I'm done, there's copies for everyone too. Myth: the challenges at CSO are due to inadequate state and insurance reimbursement rates. Fact: additional state funding would certainly help bolster mental health services at CSO and other taxpayer-funded agencies. That is why frontline clinicians have pushed for and won millions in new investments in mental health and disability services in recent years. This conflict comes down to how CSO prioritizes its existing funding and whether or not agency managers are willing to respect and value the critical services provided by frontline clinicians and crisis workers. Neither the agency's CEO nor her legal team has ever stated that the agency cannot afford to value these services appropriately, only that it isn't part of their current fiscal plan. Myth: CSO staff are well compensated for their services. Fact: according to an analysis of data provided by CSO, the median annualized income for a fee-for-service clinician is only $38,000. Many earn less as they are not classified as full-time staff. This income must also cover any paid time off outside of hours provided by the new sick time law. The median wage for all salaried employees is just $15.35 per hour, and only $12.75 per hour for workers who provide support to families. Nearly a third of the agency earn less than $15 an hour. By federal standards, these are near poverty level wages for a family of four. And I'm realizing I'm not going to have enough time to go over all of it, but there's a lot more numbers that are similar, and they're all on here that I'm going to pass out. I don't want to, it'll go over a lot of time.
Thank you, Ms. Buckingham. You can distribute them. Phil Wilson.
Hi, I'm Phil Wilson. I live at 12 Pilgrim Drive in Northampton. I'm not a rabbi, but I'm still going to tell the truth. I'd like to speak just a little bit about the real consequences of the kinds of pressures and the harsh realities that we labor under, and how our clients, the people that we work with and try to hopefully better their existence, how they really suffer these consequences. Just to give you an example, whereas I'm paid lavishly myself, I probably make $17 or $18 an hour, which is much more so than the bachelor's level people who work with me side by side in the same cases. And one of the things, children that we work with are often benefited by having what's called a therapeutic mentor. And a therapeutic mentor gets quite a bit less than I would get. And for quite a while, I have a 10-year-old girl that I work with, and I always thought she would benefit from a therapeutic mentor, but I was told repeatedly that she didn't really qualify because she'd never been hospitalized. She didn't really act out much in school. However, both of her parents have severe cognitive deficits. If you were to observe this girl in her house, you would see that it was a very disorganized mess. The parents are really not much different than 6 or 7 year olds themselves, and are really unable to provide the kind of stimulation this girl would need. So a therapeutic mentor would be absolutely terrific. And after months and months, I finally convinced people at CSO to assign a therapeutic mentor. And for 3 months or so, it worked out just fabulously. But after 3 months, the therapeutic mentor got another job and left the agency. And this happened, I would say, a year and a half ago. And since then, I haven't been able to find anyone who's willing to advocate for a replacement. So this girl is kind of left to her own devices in her family with little stimulation and little to really spark her imagination. She can barely read and write. She's in fourth grade. And that's the consequences that
we
deal with.
If you could wrap it up, please, 3 minutes.
Sure. That's it.
Thank you, sir.
Fanny Chalfin.
Okay, hi, I'm Fanny Chalfin. I live at 35 Milton Street in Florence. And I worked at CSO, but I couldn't afford to keep working at CSO. I have a private practice. It was actually costing me more than it was worth to try to work there. And I can vouch for everything everyone else said. And there's no way anyone who's a clinician there makes $50,000 a year. That just seems way exaggerated. And as a blind clinician, I asked for an electronic copy of a DSM-5, which would, you could have 3 copies, which meant that the other clinicians could use it in the clinician room as well. But I was denied the electronic copy, which I could have accessed with a voice synthesizer. You can imagine I can't read the text. So that's part of supporting the clinicians, right? And as a somatic experiencing practitioner, that's a mind-body orientation, I can tell you that if the clinicians are dysregulated because they're under so much stress, and you're using your nervous system to help the client regulate, there's a sort of catch-22 automatically in that situation. And I don't see how you could be empowering the clients when you're disempowering the clinicians. You're using the clinician normally as a model of empowerment to help the client become more empowered. So if the clinicians are always being disrespected and feel like they're not being valued and feeling stressed because they're not financially able to make ends meet, I really don't understand how you're expected to do the work right there. But CSO pretends to be a trauma-based clinic. And the clinicians have said, you know, if you're trauma-based, that you want to be sensitive to not triggering or traumatizing the clients. But you don't want to be traumatizing the clinicians who have to worry about financially making ends meet and feeling like they're not supported. But the administration doesn't seem to get the connection between how could you be a trauma-based clinic and be traumatizing the clinicians who have to worry if they're going to have a retirement, or sick days, which are supposed to be legal, they have to make up. So I could go on, but I'll just stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Chalfin. That concludes the list of those people who have signed up. If anybody else would like to speak, please come forward, say your name and address, and feel free to speak. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Stephanie Agnew. I live at 184 South Street, and I am an outpatient clinician at CSO. I love this community. I live in this community. I've chosen to raise my children in this community. And the way that I have chosen to give back to this community is to work in community mental health. But working at CSO and continuing to work without a contract and not having a raise that meets cost of living increases, it's really hard for me to continue to make that choice. And I feel in a lot of ways that I'm going to be pushed into private practice, and that is not going to help the community in the same way. And that's all I have to say.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak?
Hi, I'm Andrew Berger. I live at 5B South Street in Williamsburg, but formerly I lived at 13 Fourth Avenue here in Northampton. I've worked at CSO for 4 years at the clinic here in Northampton. As I've said before, we serve a vital public need, helping people with mental health issues, poverty, lots of things. And I really appreciate, I just want to say how much I appreciate the resolution you all passed about a month ago, or maybe a few weeks ago, in support of CSO workers and calling for a swift and fair resolution. Last night I saw in the paper that several of you had supported workers at Hotel Northampton in their movement to have a union. It was interesting in that article how the workers gathered and they sort of marched in with a petition to Hotel Northampton, and they wanted to present it to their boss, and their boss wouldn't open the door, wouldn't come out, wouldn't meet with them. And we've had a very much a parallel situation at CSO. We presented a petition to Karen Jeffers, our CEO, and to the board members of CSO, and we received absolutely no response. So in a way, the door's been closed. I've been going to negotiation meetings since last November or maybe October. I've showed up many, many times, and I've never seen, you know, no one from management has spoken. I believe one person, I think Karen Poisson spoke once. But in general, there's been very little back and forth with management, and it hasn't been the type of process we had hoped. And so I've spent a lot of time trying to reach out to management, trying to have a conversation. And all we're asking right now is for management to meet with us to let's settle this thing. Let's find a fair resolution to this. Nobody has to lose face. You know, it could be a win-win situation. And sadly, that's not what's happening. So I ask for your support as a community, as representatives of the community, to say, you know, we support good communication and in agencies that serve the public good, and this should be happening. So thank you.
Thank you, sir. Is there anyone else who would like to speak?
Hi, everyone. My name is Norbert Bellevaux. I am a former resident of Northampton, a current resident of Leeds. I'm at 46 Evergreen Road. I'm here tonight because I feel like I owe it to the community here and to the workers at CSO and the SEIU to speak tonight. I am a former employee of CSO. I am a lucky guy in that I have a job in the public school system in a local district. I had the luxury of giving a leave of absence notice and taking a job at CSO because I was feeling a calling to do something more, something different, to give back to the community. And I started at CSO as the coordinated services manager. So it was a management position. I am an LICSW, so I have a level of licensure that you would think would afford me a higher salary than the one I was given. I was earning $42,000 a year, and it was within the first 2 weeks of my time there, back in July, this past July, that I had all the confirmation I needed of why I don't want to continue in the public domain, in a clinical setting, such as CSO. I feel like I can't afford to do the work that I really love to do. And so I immediately gave my notice, decided to go back to the school system. I originally was asked to stay on. I agreed to stay on as a fee-for-service clinician. And then on the last day of my work there, just before I went into my group that day, I was asked to leave with no explanation of why. I was told that the administration thought it was in my best interest to go, and so I did. But I felt it was my obligation to come here tonight and let you know that as a manager at CSO, as a starting salary, I was at $42,000 a year. Who can afford to live on that? Not me. So I can't afford to do that work. I was lucky enough to go back to the school system. And I just wanted to come and speak to that tonight. And that has nothing to do with the people that work there, the other managers and supervisors that I worked with. They're great people. This is about the culture. This is about the culture at CSO. And I think that needs to change. Thank you.
Sir. Is there anyone else who would like to speak? Thank you. Moving to the agenda. The clerk could call the roll, please. Oh, actually, but prior to that, if I could appoint Councilor LaBarge to enroll, please.
Councilor Adams.
Here.
Councilor Carney.
Present.
Councilor Klein.
Here.
Councilor LaBarge.
Present.
Councilor Murphy.
Here.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Here.
Councilor Shara.
Here.
Councilor Spector.
Here.
We'll move to public hearings, and it appears that there are none. Are there any communications from the mayor?
Yes. Sorry, Councilor. Actually, do you have a vote on the resolution? The resolution that folks are here speaking about? I would be willing to defer communications to the mayor so that you could take that up and I could do the communications after.
Okay, thank you, Mayor.
Yes. So the people are waiting.
Sure, right. Okay. We'll skip to item number 5, which is proclamations, resolutions, recognitions, and 1-minute announcement of events. And we'll start with the resolution. I'll waive second reading unless any of the council requests a second reading. Okay. Is there a motion to accept the resolution?
Move to approve it.
Is there a second?
Second.
Further discussion? Clerk, if you roll call vote, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
I must abstain.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes. Motion passes. I'll finish this number 5. Are there any 1-minute announcements? No. If we could now go back to communications from the mayor.
Certainly. Okay. I wanted to.
Mr. Mayor, everyone's welcome to stay, but I will point out the motion. If you're only here for that matter, that matter has been concluded and it passed 8-0 with 1 abstention. Thank you.
I can wait till they. Didn't think they were waiting for communications from the mayor.
Yeah. No, they were.
No, they're riveting. They should say.
I'm trying to withhold that power I have.
Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Vice President. I did want to communicate with the council tonight briefly, because I know the council has been receiving a lot of inquiries from constituents regarding the status of the former Fiker School building. I know councilors have been approached about that, and I did want to just give you a quick update or briefing on that, also for the public, because I know that they've people have been interested in that. The Fiker School building is currently under the control of the school committee, and the school committee has a 6.5-year lease with the Naugatuck School, a nonprofit that runs a daycare there. That lease is expiring at the end of next June, the end of the fiscal year. And so the school committee has taken up the issue of what to do at the end of the lease. So they have a vote, or they have a discussion, a debate, and a deliberation on this schedule for their September 10th meeting. And I wanted to just let you know that at this point, the council, well, I'm the chair of the school committee, but the mayor and the council's role will only come into play if, in fact, there's sort of two options that they have. The first would be to they could use the building for a school use. They could start using it again as a school. They could move an office in there, do whatever. The second option is they could vote to surplus another lease interest in the building, which is the current situation, at which point it would then have to come to the city council, because any surplus of that kind for a lease, as you know, would have to have a vote of the city council and approval of the mayor. The other option that the school committee could exercise would be to just surplus the building to school use, which would be analogous to the, for example, the Florence Community Center or the old Florence Grammar School, where they surplused it, just said we no longer need it as a building for school use, we no longer have a use for it, so we're just going to surplus it. At that point, it would then revert to, it would become a city building and would revert to the control of central services, again, much like what happened with the Florence Grammar School. And at that point, it would then become a city building, and the city would have to figure out what it wanted to do with it. So that's really, I know that the councilors have been getting inquiries about that, and I can answer any questions you have about it, but I did want you to sort of know what the process is and where we are. The school committee has taken up, will be taking up that issue at its next meeting next Thursday, September 10th, I believe that is, and they will be discussing it at that point. I do want to say to you, though, however, because I think it's important for the council to understand this information, that process is also running parallel to the process that I've been conducting with our Parks and Recreation Department, searching for a new space for the Parks and Recreation Department, which, as you know, next June will need to move off the Smith Vocational Campus. So I did want to at least alert you that if that building were to come back into city control, I'm talking about the Fiker building, I would be very interested in using that building as a new home for the Parks and Rec Department. We've been doing an analysis of all the various options for where the Parks and Rec Department could move into, including leasing, constructing modular buildings, constructing a freestanding building, and all of those options are feasible, but they carry a pretty high price tag in terms of what it would cost to do that, and we would have to obviously do a capital project and get either borrowing or appropriation authorization to do that. I was actually asked the question when I was had a forum at the senior center, which I know the counselor attended, and someone had asked me about Fiker School back when we were having to be out of the Smith Voc campus this June, and of course that building was under lease for another year, so it was really not in play and it wasn't anything that we could talk about. But if the school committee were to surplus the building to the city, I just wanted to let you know that it is something that I am exploring very seriously. We've looked at it, the size, obviously the city has invested money in it. The city maintains it through the Central Services Department, paid for by the school budget at this point, as part of the current lease. But I wanted you to be aware of that. So I will obviously keep you updated. The school committee will be taking up the issue. I don't know if they'll actually take a vote on this one way or the other, but I did also just want to give you a heads up, because I will very soon have to bring to you some kind of order to move forward on a Parks and Rec facility or a place there where they can move, because obviously we only have until next June to move them off the Smith Vocational Campus, and we'll need lead time under any scenario to do whatever construction documents, whatever procurement we need to do to move them to a new facility. If there are any questions, I'm happy to answer any. Counselor.
So until the school committee acts one way or another, it's not an action item for the council?
No. I mean, I'll obviously be participating in that as chair of the school committee, and I'm, you know, one of 10 votes. And obviously, I will let the school committee know of this as well. But until such time that it becomes, I mean, there's possible that they could surplus for a lease, and that would come to the city council as well.
To do the lease.
There would have to be any action taken on that city building, because of the law, it would still require city council and mayor approval. But at this point, there's really no role unless and until the school committee determines what it's going to do with the building. I mean, they could also let the building stay empty. There's nothing, I mean, if they did not want to use the building and just wanted to keep it and leave it empty, they could certainly do that. Though, knowing the school budget, I don't believe we'd want to heat an empty building or take care of an empty building. So
if they went with the lease option, it would fall to us to negotiate that lease.
The mayor would.
And it would come here for approval.
Yeah, well, they would probably present a lease. They would probably work on a lease and then come to us for come to you for approval. It's analogous to, say, the Clark School arrangement at Leeds School, where they leased property at the Leeds building to Clark School. And so the final step of that, after having negotiated the lease was subject to the city council surplusing the lease interest in the city-owned building.
Mm-hmm. And if they surplus it and turn it over to the city and have no more school use for it, you're telling us that, well, you would have a use for it because we have the place to put the recreation people. So it's unlikely that you would come to us to sell it to a third party, because we'd have a municipal use for the building if we got it back.
That is correct. And I know you know my general philosophy since becoming mayor has been that if we don't have a building that we're not going to use, we should try to sell it, like we did the Florence Community Center. And I think that was very successful. In this case,
there's a use.
We do have a use that we would need it for. But again, I don't want to jump the gun. But I also want to be up front with the council about my thinking on this and what I've been looking at as part of this separate analysis of the Parks and Rec Department building.
Great. Thank you.
Councilor Scheer?
Is there any way that it could be divided so that part of it would be surplus and part of it would be leased, or is that just not practical or feasible?
You can certainly, there's always that possibility. The challenge would be the space requirements. That would be the challenge.
Right now, the preschool utilizes the whole
building. The entire space. Yeah, the entire space is utilized. So that would be one of the challenges. I mean, certainly, the Leeds School is a perfect example. There were two classrooms that weren't being used, and those classrooms were surplused and converted into Clark School classrooms. So that certainly can be done. I just don't know how feasible that would be.
Based on the size that Parks and Rec need and also what's being used right now.
That would pose challenges, yeah. So that would be my answer.
Are there any other questions for the mayor or comments? Is that all you have, Mr. Mayor?
That's my only communication this
evening.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move to agenda item number 6. I don't believe there are any presentations or petitions, but there are two licenses. If the council pleases, I'd like to accept a motion for Modern Myths and Sekhmet LLC doing business as Find as a group.
Move as a group. Second. Whatever. Are you actually making a motion?
I'm asking for the motion. Motion made. Is there a second? Is there any discussion on these?
Second.
Just, as a matter of course, all the documents are in order from the clerk and that kind of thing. So just to state that for the record.
Yeah. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Next, we move to number 8, approval of minutes of the previous meeting. Is there a motion to approve?
Move to approve.
As a group.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? There will be no finance tonight, so we will not recess for finance, and we'll move to number 10, which is reports of committees, appointments, and elections. A, under 10, is contracted services for audit of city books and accounts. Pursuant to Northampton City Charter, Article 7, Section 6, the City Council will consider the award of a contract providing for outside auditing of books and accounts of the city to be conducted by a certified public accountant or firm of certified public accountants. I'll accept the motion and put it on the floor. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Perhaps Councilor Murphy would be willing to explain
make a report, because the Finance Committee did the preliminary work on this. We met over the last 2 weeks, and at our first meeting 2 weeks ago, we reviewed the responses to RFP. Mr. Cook from the procurement officer reviewed them, performed them, make sure they were complete, and they met the requirements of the RFP. And we had a total of 4 bids that met the requirement. We discussed them and then chose to interview, and we did that earlier this week, the 4 companies that bid. And the 4 companies were Mendelsohn and Heath, Clifton and Larson and Allen, Powers and Sullivan, and Scanlon Associates. So on Tuesday of this week, the Finance Committee met. Councilor Adams and Councilor Scarra, myself, and Councilor LaBarge, and we proceeded to interview all of the companies and then deliberated about it and decided that what we do is bring 2 companies with our recommendation to this body for further discussion. Basically, we've had a relationship with the auditors, Scanlon and Associates, for many, many years. And under the charter, this is the first time the City Council, as a result of the charter, has been charged with actually selecting the auditor. And so this is the first time we've done this, and we felt we needed to have a process to respect the requirement that's in the charter. So what we decided to do was to bring forward Scanlon and Associates, which is our current auditor, and then the other company that we want to bring forward is Powers and Sullivan, based on the interview. Of the 3 companies that we have not had a relationship with to this point, we selected Powers and Sullivan. It was a unanimous decision to bring them forward as the other choice. Now, our discussions to this point had been, we were never dissatisfied with the service of Scanlon Associates, but the concept was brought forward that perhaps at some point a new set of eyes would make a difference in the selection of an auditor. And since we'd not done it before, we decided to investigate that concept. So our proposal to bring forward to the council for discussion is that Scanlon Associate bid $196,600, and we're bringing forward Powers and Sullivan because of the results of the interview. It just so happens that they were the next lowest bidder at $207,000. And there was a requirement. We had to do a little checking to create some parity because the bids were a little bit different. And there were some issues like doing grants at the school department, and without a little bit of work, it was hard to determine where they stacked up financially. But I would dare say our selection of Powers and Sullivan, you know, it just happened they were the second lowest bidder. They impressed us at the interview. So what we wanted to do is bring forward for council discussion either the concept of keeping Scanlon and Associates, who was the lowest bidder, and again, this has not come about because we're dissatisfied with them. We just wanted to discuss the concept of having new auditors for the first time in years. And Powers and Sullivan, their bid was $10,400 higher, but we felt, based on the interviews, that they were the most qualified, in our opinion, of the other 3 that we have not done business with yet. So we wanted to bring them forward to you and see how you felt about it at this point, after we did that preliminary work. Does that, the other members of that committee, does that pretty much summarize what came out of our meeting? All right, so I'll throw it back to the chair,
just,
and we can have some discussion.
Sure, and just to point out, Mr. James Power is here from Powers and Sullivan, if the council chooses to recognize him. And of course, the finance director is present as well, if there are any questions for the finance director. So we can open it up to discussion, and I think what should happen is ultimately there should be a motion to accept one or the other.
Can I add just one more thing? All of the companies that bid were quite capable of doing this work for us. We selected Powers and Sullivan as the one we thought was the most appropriate.
Yep.
But all of the companies are in this business. They're well known, they're well established, they do a lot of municipal work. So nobody bid on this that was incompetent and shouldn't, you know, and couldn't do the work. We just happened to select Powers and Sullivan as the one we thought was the best match, and I'll throw it over to
Councilor Spector, Councilor Shira.
Well, I guess I would like to hear, because this committee worked on this, that I understand the argument is we should have a new set of eyes looking at it. I'd like to hear the arguments for that, because for years we've had Scanlon. They've been a very good company. I think many times, even in the administration before, we've praised their work over and over, their presentation, the way they've done it. I remember sitting here and finally understanding some things because of the way Scanlon even presented things. And no one has ever complained about their work. So I'd like to hear the arguments for why go to another company, because I'm sure that's, you guys discussed it. And I know that the change is because it's in the charter that we need to do that. But I'd like to hear what your discussions were like to move me to say, okay, I'm willing to move to someone else, even though we've got somebody who everybody has said has been excellent.
Councilor Shira?
Before speaking to that, I just wanted to thank our clerk, Pam Powers, who did an amazing amount of job putting together the RFP in a very short period of time, and then analyzing the proposals that came in. She really did a huge amount of work. And I mean, if appropriate, I feel like Pam would also be a good person to answer questions as well, because she really studied these very thoroughly.
Do you want me to start the response to that, to Councilor Spector's questions?
If Councilor LaBarge could speak first, and then
sure.
Perhaps you
okay.
Could right after. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Spector, I agree with you 100%. I did bring this up on Tuesday in Finance Committee. We did have an excellent selection, but for the 18 years that I was a councilor, and Scanlon has been working for the city, I think, what, a good 25 years, I have never heard any of the other two mayors ever say that they've had a problem with Scanlon at all. So I agree with Paul. I don't have a problem keeping the same auditor that's been doing the city for 25 years. But we have had some excellent, excellent candidates.
Councilor Murphy?
And I just want to point out, and again, the other members of the committee that were there can chime in. That was one of the questions we asked the auditors, was twofold. Many of them, in their resumes, had indicated how long they'd been auditing certain cities. You know, part of their resume said, well, we've been having happy clients, we've done this city for 15 years and this city for 18 years. So it's a two-sided thing. You know, everybody said yes. Sometimes when you switch auditors, you know, you pick something up. But at the same time, most of them thought it was a credit to their companies that they'd stayed in places and kept their clients happy that long. And many of them offered the opportunity that, you know, they're all reasonably good-sized companies, they're not two-person shops, that sometimes changing the members of the audit team year to year, having people do different jobs, you know, you're not always, you know, working on one thing, you move around a little bit, creates the new eyes. So on one hand, they said, yeah, sometimes new eyes helps. On the other hand, they were all very proud of how long they'd served some of these communities consecutively. So it seemed like, to some extent, it was a draw. If they're in a community and they're keeping that community happy, they stay a long time, and there's really no problem with that. And they accomplish the new eyes sometimes by just switching the team members. Is that a good representation of what we?
Yes, sure.
Yes, and I mean, it was interesting to hear that other communities do often stay with their auditor for a long time. But I mean, just to sort of speak to the new eyes idea a little bit more, I think everyone agrees that Scanlon's done a great job. No one has complaints about them. And I don't think anyone thinks that they've been complacent, but I think the reason we wanted to explore this is the idea that even if, you know, if someone is looking at things thoroughly every year, when you're intimately, you know, familiar with a city and the departments and have done this work for as long as they have, it's not necessarily a complacency, but there might be things that you don't pick up on because you're not seeing them for the first time. So, I mean, I think that's what some, you know, the idea behind this.
Councilor Spector?
Just a question. Did anyone ask of other cities and towns whether they change when they're liking their auditor, they think things go well, have talked to other cities and towns of what they've done? And
Due to the Powers and Sullivan was the first group that presented, and due to the fact that they presented first and they had a lot of experience, I actually asked that question to Mr. Powers. And I believe he told me very objectively, he said, some go 20 plus years, some go as little as three rotations. Some may hire one firm for 3 years and then rotate to another firm.
So communities do all over the place.
Yes, certainly some stay 20 plus years as we have, but certainly some choose to go in a different direction. Councilor O'Donnell?
And another related question I have is there any guidance or advice from the state, from Department of Local Services or whatever? Are there any best practices that the state recommends on this matter?
I think that might be, and again, that might be something we might want to ask Susan Wright about, because she, you know, she's the finance director and she would have gotten any recommendations on that one. So that may be one the chair wants to ask Susan about.
Donna, did you want to pose that question to the finance director?
Well, may we recognize the finance director?
I'll second that.
What specifically is the question?
I guess it's not the most specific question in the world. I'm just wondering if there are state guidelines about how municipalities select auditors and who audits the auditor. There are none.
We're so highly regulated by the Department of Revenue that, you know, our audits, all auditors working in the state of Massachusetts for municipalities have to meet the requirements that are set forth. I will say that many communities stay with the same auditor for years. If you look through the proposals, a lot of them have kept the same auditors. All of the Cook firms were qualified, but I will say that I don't think the financial team is at all nervous about switching, because we believe we're doing everything correctly. We don't believe that there's any smoking guns or new things that are going to be uncovered that are erroneous in our procedures. We feel pretty confident that we're doing everything correctly. So we're not concerned about that, but we do have a very good working relationship with our current auditor.
Councilor Murphy, is it a question for the finance director, or just a point?
Just a point that one of the other things that came out in the discussions, and more than one of them mentioned this, that this is not like a forensic audit that, you know, that might be done under great pressure, that a lot of what they communicate to us after the audit is in the management letter, where they make suggestions about policies and procedures. And for those who have been around for a while, you remember in years past, sometimes they made some recommendations for changes in department procedures and things of that nature. But I think they all agreed the type of audit that they're doing here is, it's not a forensic audit for fraud or anything like that. It's different than that, and most of what they tell us that I've seen is contained in their management letter, where they say, "Here's areas where you could do some improvement or tightening things up." That's where they do that sort of thing.
Councilor Klein, Councilor LaBarge.
I have another question for you, Susan. I'm just wondering if you would feel comfortable expressing your sense of whether or not a change would be onerous to your department, what your thoughts and feelings are about going with a new firm versus staying with Scanlon.
I think the fact that Scanlon and Associates has audited the town for the city for so long, it makes the audit process a lot quicker. For the staff, they're usually here for about 3 or 4 solid weeks, usually end of September, early October. It takes quite a bit of staff time during that time, but they've done, because they have all of the preliminary work, and they know our community and our system and our processes so well, they can come in and they can come out. It will take longer, at least the first year.
Councilor Barge.
Thank you. I know Councilor Gina Louise Shera had commended Pamela Powers, and I agree to that, but I also want to commend Susan Wright and Joe Cook for starting this off and guiding her, because a big responsibility was put on your hands. And thank you, Susan, very, very much. And we did miss you Tuesday night. I wish you were here, because it was questions we probably could have gotten from you. So thank you.
And I wanted to point out for the other councilors that were not members of the Finance Committee that to some extent, we choose the auditor as the legislative body to audit the administration and the financial officers of the city. So it's really improper for the auditor or the finance director or the treasurer collector, the people that are the focus of the audit, to actually make a recommendation or in any way trying to influence. So they could help us to an extent, but they had to keep a distance from this decision. So Susan's going to be very political when you ask her questions, because this is our selection of an auditor to audit our administration and our finance departments. So they really have to keep some distance from this, you know, decision. It's our decision. So, you know, that they could help us to a limited extent. But that's why when we did the interviews, the financial team was not there, because they're essentially the ones that the auditor would audit. So that's why they can't advocate one way or the other. It's our decision.
Councilor Sherrod, Councilor O'Donnell.
I just want to clarify that, you know, I don't think any of us sort of embarked on this process because we were concerned that there was going to be, that a different auditor would find any malfeasance or anything that wasn't being done correctly. It's just the idea that maybe a different group would have other suggestions or other sort of helpful information they could give us, not that we think that there's something hidden that could be uncovered by someone else. I just want to clarify that.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yeah, I'd just like to just offer a quick opinion, which is, I mean, this is, oh yeah, I'm double mic'd here because there's a conspiracy that cut off my mic. I don't know. What I was going to say is, it seems like we're dealing with a new provision of the new charter to mm-hmm. an extent, and we haven't really exercised the power to select a new independent auditor. So to me, I mean, I do see the value in the experimentation of it. It sounds like there was a lot of sentiment in the Finance Committee that there's value there. I know the Council Vice President has talked about this, you know, last year too. And so just to put the burden of proof on the other side, I mean, what is the downside of trying this new method? Maybe it will work out to the benefit of the city financially with an audit that catches something that wasn't caught before. Or, you know, I guess I don't see the downside, except I understand that the price is a little higher, but we are talking about the budget of the entire city, and so maybe that is worth the cost just to see if we get a result that is beneficial.
Thank you. Powers and Sullivan did state, pursuant to, I believe, Councilor LaBarge's question, that they were willing to negotiate. They're $10,400 higher than Scanlon, and so it's about over a three-year period, so that's about $3,000 a year. But they did state that they would potentially be willing to negotiate some of that. But my request, it would be if there could be a motion to recognize Mr. Powers, so that myself and others could ask him a couple questions. Is there a motion to that effect?
Move to recognize Mr. Powers.
Is there a second? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
There's no one here from Scanlon, correct?
That's right.
Can anybody on the committee speak? Because this feels a little awkward that we have one representative.
Exactly.
Would speak to the other.
And I can tell you just my notes that I took while they were
speaking. Yeah, it still makes me a little uncomfortable.
Me too.
They were all invited. So, I mean, whoever responded, responded. I mean, but I can tell you, Scanlon, so Scanlon said they're familiar with us. They're still the most inexpensive. There have been no, this is not about complaints. So they feel that they've done an adequate job. And they also said that they had different people doing different things, and they felt that that was something of an equivalent of giving it new eyes. And they also said, he kept emphasizing that if you don't change, this is what he said, you don't change your doctor if they're doing a good job. You don't change your lawyer if they're doing a good job. Some of us on the committee felt that that wasn't an apt analogy, but they felt strongly that they were doing a good job and they're still the cheapest. So those are the notes that I have from their presentation. But again, they were all invited. What I wanted to ask Mr. Powers was, we asked you about the transition, the transition period that were to occur if we were to go with your firm. Could you describe what you would envision the transition period to be, please?
Well, the transition period is, especially since this is for next year's audit, so there's plenty of time if you make a selection that we have plenty of time to make a transition. One of the most important things that we do is plan. We need to sit down with not only the finance committee of the and lay out what we do to audit, what we expect to do to audit. One of the things is that there isn't a we use audit programs, the standards that we go through. I think somebody said, who audits the auditor? And we actually have to have, and Tom Scanlon and his firm gets peer-reviewed every 3 years to make sure that we're quality firms, and all four of the firms, I believe, are quality firms and capable of completing the audit. But audit is judgment. So we may do things different than Scanlon has. We may look at different things for different reasons. And so you won't find the same thing that occur all the time. There are some basics that we'll all do that has to occur. Treasurer's office, collector's office, assessor's office, the major schools, the grants, et cetera, for the single audits, but there are different things that we do. What we like to do is sit down first with the administration, everybody else, and kind of let them know who we are and what we expect. We also use what we call an audit manual, which lays out the audit in detail for each section. It's a formal document we do with timing in there, responsibilities of Powers and Sullivan, responsibilities of the city as we go through, and who's in the timing relative to that. We make sure everybody's aware of what goes through and how that process proceeds. We take on most of the burden of making that transition. If we're hired, we'll talk to Scanlon about what they found, what their issues were, and that's a normal course in the transition. But it should be, I don't say relatively simple. There'll be more time, but most of the time will be on us. We audit 70 of these every year, at least. And so, although you're unique, you're not that unique. You're still a city. You provide pretty much the same services. Unique from the standpoint that you have two school districts inside of the town, so that's still a little bit different. But we'd be auditing the schools in a similar manner. We would also have a department would request that would have a departmental meeting to sit back and address all of their concerns and say, this is when the timing is, this is what we expect, what do you expect from you, and call us up with any questions at all to make sure that that transition goes smoothly, and it's not as disruptive as everybody thinks by transitioning the audit. Things that we'll do, things that would part of the RFP was a request to go and visit various departments throughout the year. Well, that would be done probably in the January, February, March timeframe when people aren't as busy, it's not closing around year end. We can still take a look at the systems, and we give plenty of time to make sure that the right staff are there when we go in and visit each one. So, and we view this as a year-long commitment. And at any time throughout the year, if anybody has any questions, whether it's finance or school or anybody else, we're open for those type of things. If you need meetings, we don't bill extra for that. It's just part of the services that are provided. And so we take care of that part of it. We'll take care of putting together the financial statements for a finance director's review to make sure that the financials are in place, and they'll be in place well before that. Other transitions issues that we do, things that we can do up front. We can do the retirement system well before June 30th. We'll take last year's financial statements. We'll have all those things laid out. We'll have everything coded, ready to go. We provide a complete crosswalk between your ledgers and the actual financial statements. So every adjustment, audit adjustment that we make and propose is understood by finance. And so there's a various There's a number of steps that we go through. All of them are completely transparent. And we plan for this all the way along, and the planning doesn't stop just at, you know, we have a couple of meetings in the spring, and then we'll see you in several months. It continues as we go. So that's kind of how we do the transition. And it really is not that disruptive. It's new. We'll ask different things. There'll be different people. But I wouldn't expect that it would be that burdensome on your staff.
Councilor Barge.
Thank you very much for giving us that presentation. Councilor Adams, as a city councilor, I'm not happy about this, the way that this is occurring. I would like to know, Scanlon was notified about being here tonight? Was he notified?
It's my understanding, and can be corrected if I'm wrong, that they were all invited to be here.
And the replies back were that they could not make it?
I didn't extend any invitations.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. There were none, I apologize, and I was wrong. There were none extended. I was wrong.
Thank you.
So I guess they came voluntarily. But it was all equal. Councilor Murphy?
To focus the discussion, I'd like to move we grant the auditing contract to Scanlon Associates.
Second.
Councilor Spector.
So I guess I would just ask councilors here to think about this. I don't know how many people here have their own business or have ever had their own business, but or even if you have a CPA who does your taxes. But if you find somebody who's really good, who you've liked for years, who you build a relationship with, because some of this is how do you work together, and I'm sure you do a great, great job. But I know for me, I mean, there was a period of time where I was changing people I worked with because I do have my own business way back. And I would change every couple of years because I wasn't completely satisfied or I felt it was too expensive. So two things, either they weren't doing good work or it was too expensive. But I never changed, and I would ask anybody here to think, would you change in your own business if you found a good working relationship, you were really satisfied with the work, and it was actually the lowest bid you had? Now I hear that it may be an equal bid, so there's not an economic incentive. And I guess just, you know, maybe I'm getting old, and it's like if it ain't broke, don't fix it. I mean, that's probably just as you get older, you say, boy, I don't want to change things so much. But there's a part of this that's just the human piece, and for having been here for over 10 years, hearing Scanlon's reports and watching them, I've really appreciated the way in which they have been available and the way they've presented it. So that's another thing. It's not just the work itself, but I've really appreciated that. And so I won't be here next year to hear that report, but I would hope all of you would have a great one. And so my feeling would be, think about this. If it was your own business, your own life, would you go ahead and play around with it? So
to answer that question, certainly I would. But that's because they would probably tell me what I want to hear. And that's the point for me. I mean, that's really my point. But I'm not going to vote for Scanlon. And the reason why is just some of the things that I liked about Powers and Sullivan, they do 95% municipal work. That's not to compare it to Scanlon because I don't know what Scanlon's breakout is, but here's what I like about them. They came here, they knew the specifics of the city. They mentioned the landfill, the stormwater fee, Gadsby, that we have two school districts. They showed a lot of knowledge in that regard. And the thing that struck me most was that they had some additional ideas for new transparency. And to me, that's the whole crux of the reason why we need new eyes. This isn't our business. This is the public's money. It's the taxpayers' money. And I think that they can bring some new ideas, at least for 3 years. I mean, we can go back to Scanlon after. But I think that there's value having them come in as a different firm. It's possible, even if it hasn't happened yet, to get overly comfortable and overly familiar with Scanlon. And I feel that, you know, I don't have DOR to back this up, but my opinion is it's a better practice after a quarter century to get someone in there, especially when they already have some ideas for new additional transparency. So I'm against the motion to support Scanlon Associates. Now, Councilor O'Donnell.
What is our timeline for making this decision?
That's a good question. I'm not exactly sure, but if it's not too strict, we can put this back for further process. We can re-invite others, or
I mean, I hate, you know,
perhaps the mayor may know a better answer for you than I do.
I think the charter says September 15th.
Right.
So you have,
okay. I believe that's we were told that.
You have to appoint, so you have to make the appointments.
Before our next meeting.
I'm just to follow up, I'm just sensitive to Councilor Spector's comment that you made, Councilor, before your last one about, we have one candidate here, but not both.
Mm-hmm.
Then again, the whole point is that the city is very familiar with our current auditor. I don't know that it makes sense to bring two groups together and grill them in front of the whole city council, but nonetheless, I'm sensitive to that appearance issue that Councilor Spector raised. And frankly, and also, I mean, I'm not sure that I have, you know, the resumes or the proposals in front of me as part of tonight's council packet, to be quite honest. I'm sure they were in the Finance Committee agenda and I could have pulled them up, but I don't know that I'm comfortable making a decision tonight.
Councilor Spector.
So, yeah, I'm uncomfortable too, but I'm uncomfortable mostly. I don't understand why the Finance Committee didn't kind of take the vote themselves, because this is what you guys were doing. You were talking to people, it'll take us a while, but why didn't you guys, you know, most of the time we come forward on a committee and somebody puts a motion forward and says we recommend this or that, and you guys chose to bring two forward, which feels a little uncomfortable. It's not just not having them here, because this isn't anything I'm familiar with after all these years. I don't even know the questions to ask. I haven't been on finance, I haven't worked with this. We haven't been part of the discussions. That was your job. And so I'm a little bit like, well, why don't you recommend one or the other? And then given us those reasons, so I had to actually ask you, pull this out of, what were your reasons? And to take that vote among yourselves, and you guys have been familiarizing yourself with the issues. I would have preferred that, and to hear your rationale.
Can I answer that?
Councilor
Finance. All of the companies we saw were capable of doing the work. It really came down to the question of new eyes versus, you know, we had no complaints with Scanlon. The whole reason behind this is, are we compelled to switch to another company to get new eyes, or are we happy staying with somebody we've had a, you know, 18 or 20 year relationship with? And the Finance Committee did not choose to make that decision for the council. What we did was, we brought you back the lowest bidder who we've had a relationship with, and we brought you who we thought was the most qualified of the other three companies that could do the job for us, and decided, you know, the new eyes was the reason, one of the reasons we're doing this. That's a, we felt was a council decision.
Okay.
How bad do you all want new eyes, or are you willing to stay with our existing auditor?
I understand that. I still think that it's the essence of the argument, but I think I would like answers to the question of what communities have switched and why. And you've brought up some yourself. What are the recommendations by the state? There are a number of questions which I would have thought would have been asked there that we don't have that data in front of us, that perhaps then would have led you to a decision, say, look, we're one of the unique communities which has had an auditor for this long. There are very few others that have done this. Most communities change. Here's the reasons they do. The state recommends this, or the Organization of International Auditors recommend that local communities change. I would have liked to have seen some of that, which we don't have here. Maybe we can get it next time. Mm-hmm. But I think those are the kind of questions around that very essence of the issue.
Which you wouldn't have got answered if we did what you said, which was just bring back one person.
No, I'm saying
We did do that work, and we discovered, and I think I mentioned it earlier, some communities stay with an auditor for a long period of time, and they're perfectly fine with that. Others change. In fact, it might have been even Mr. Powers that said that one community uses one set of auditors for 3 years, then switches to another company, then switches back to the previous company.
Exactly.
That's just the way they do it. So.
And do you know the name of, is that a community in Massachusetts?
Yeah.
Do we have the name
of
that?
Well, these are all,
Mr. Powers, Miami.
I don't recall, but all of these companies audit many municipalities in Massachusetts. You know, they all are competent to do the work. It really does come back
to
that question.
So,
you know, do you or don't you want to change for the sake of change? Because they're both good companies. You know, and as I said, the question was new eyes, and we didn't want to answer that for the council as a whole. We brought you two competent companies that could do the work reliably, and one we know and one's new. That's why we get the big money. We got to make these decisions.
Councilor Klein?
So I find both of these arguments very compelling. I think that the new eyes makes a lot of sense. I think that to be sure that we're really studying the finances in ways that will potentially reveal any problems, I think that's a really important thing for us to do. I also, what Councilor Spector is saying makes a lot of sense to me. You know, if it can be done fast and efficiently, and listening to Susan Wright say that, you know, they've worked with this company successfully for so long, that's all compelling as well. One of the bottom lines is that we have to decide, I think we have to decide based on price. If we have one company saying $196,000 versus 2007, we have the possibility as a council to save our city some money here. I do understand, though, that Powers is saying that they will negotiate the price. I feel like if we can get the prices to an even keel, that it does behoove us to think about getting a different company with new eyes, maybe for a period of a few years, not necessarily in an ongoing way. But so I have two things I'm thinking about. I think it's a great idea to bring new eyes to our financial audit, but I also think it's really important for us to find the best person, the best company for the lowest price. So if we're able to do both of those things, then I feel like that's how I would want to make a decision.
I could just address Councilor Spector, your point before. In my mind, the reason why, rather than choosing one and making the recommendation, we chose two is because if we chose one, certainly the council could reject that. Then we have to go back to the drawing board, and we only have till the 15th. And if we chose one, that the likelihood, though, it's only a likelihood and nothing more, that company would have gotten chosen, rather than we've had, I think, a really good, robust discussion tonight about what's the best direction to go. And I think that's what it's led to. And I think that was a wise choice on our part.
I'd like to make a motion to table this to the next meeting. If my understanding is we don't need to vote on this evening.
Where would that take us to? Okay, we would have to do a special meeting if that were the case.
I'm sorry.
Which can be done. I also wanted to point out that this is not a measure that takes two votes to pass.
Our next meeting is the 17th.
One vote, the appointment's made, so we don't have the benefit of learning more about after this vote.
Okay.
So if the council wants more time to learn and figure out some of the answers to some of the questions, a special meeting may be in order. Councilor Labarge, Councilor Klein.
Didn't the mayor say that the deadline was the 15th, and we have a city council meeting on the 17th?
It was the 15th last year, and I think you guys did it on the 17th.
Okay.
You're all still out of jail, so I know it's whatever. I'm just saying that last year it didn't happen before the 15th, I don't think. So, but I did. That's what the charter says.
Drive to abide by that.
That's exactly what I'm just saying.
Yeah. Thank you, Mayor. Councilor Klein?
I'm just wondering if there's a way in which we can get an adjusted figure from Powers so that we know what we're talking about, and maybe that means waiting to the next meeting, or maybe we can do that now.
Mr. Powers, are you in the position to answer that question?
Yeah. This I do object to.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I do object to this because I do these things all the time, but if you're going to be changing figures, if we're going to change figures, that is unfair to do without a Scanlon Associate representative here.
I agree. I agree.
So
this is wrong.
Because we can't negotiate with one party alone.
Then I would suggest we table this to the next meeting.
Well, I would suggest we do a special meeting so we can abide by the 15th deadline per charter. I think that's probably better done with the council president. I can try to schedule it now with the council here if they prefer, but
just a question. So if we don't do a special meeting, so we then have not done it by the 15th, and we all end up spending time in jail. I mean, what are the consequences?
Well, as
the, I would spend a night in jail.
As the mayor said, we did it last time. We missed the deadline. There was no consequence. My plan was we do. It's the third. We have till the 15th. If we can schedule a special meeting,
if we can,
consistent with the charter. That's,
well, did we vote for a motion to postpone, or are we just discuss it?
Well.
We're
there's still
no second.
There's a motion
so
on the table.
Well,
I'd second a motion to continue into the next special meeting.
I'll second that.
And for the purposes of inviting Scanlon?
So you said a special meeting?
Yeah. Only because if we postpone to a regular meeting, it would be after the 15th.
Which would be the 17th.
I'm wondering, what are the consequences of doing it at the I mean, I'm perfectly willing to, if we pass the motion to table it to a special meeting and then try and find a date that we cannot find for a special meeting, that we're going to, I guess then we can undo
the
motion.
Well, then I would make,
postpone
make,
it.
I would structure the motion that we postpone it until a meeting of a suitable date, you know, before the 15th.
Okay. I would second that motion.
And just to, may I speak to that motion to postpone? I mean, I don't know whether you want to, you know, have the other auditors come in or what, but I just feel that the main motion here is to approve Scanlon. And I mean, I don't feel at this point that, to Councilor Klein's point, of do we know enough to outweigh the additional cost in terms of the benefit here, I frankly just feel that I can't make that decision today. And I feel like the other thing about continuing this is that if we're going to continue it, we can't just be in the same position that we're in tonight at that time. So we need some kind of commitment to answer specific questions that we all need answered in order to make a decision.
Councilor Murphy.
That was going to be my next question. You know, I've heard tonight that, well, maybe finance should have done all the work and brought one person. Now I'm hearing you don't have enough information to decide between two. So if you're going to postpone, please come up with what you're going to do between now and the next meeting to get whatever information you think you need, you got to get, so that we could make a decision a week from now. Because this committee work was done by finance already. So exactly what steps are you going to take to get comfortable between now and whenever another meeting is going to happen?
Can I just respond?
Sure. If you'd like
very,
to respond.
Just very briefly. I mean, I think, the Councilman Murphy brings up a good point. And I think that the main question is, it's less about data and information and more about the philosophy. Do we want to switch for the sake of switching? And I just feel that that case, at least to me, hasn't been made, but maybe there is data we can find to support that. That's all. I mean, I'm willing to do it. Like I say, I think it could be a worthwhile experiment. But this is a contract for 3 years. That's all. So, mm-hmm.
Councilor Klein.
Yeah, I just want to say that I certainly didn't mean to cast aspersions on the work of the Finance Committee. I think you did a fine job.
Thank you.
And thank you for that work. I know that it's grueling to interview. There are two things. I think Councilor O'Donnell pointed out that we want to see if we can find some more information about this idea of getting new eyes, so that's one thing. And the other thing that I think is really important is what the price is that we can negotiate with Powers. So those would be the two central pieces to me, and I think we need to have some process about how we're going to gather this information.
Okay, well, there's a motion to postpone on the table. We can take a vote on that, but I think we might want to figure out concretely what we want to do if this motion passes. Do we want to have a special meeting? I'd like to ask the council, if it's the council's pleasure, if they want to try to schedule today, or if Councilor Dwight and the council clerk can put out some proposed dates in the next few days if they can, or what specifically we'd like to see. Do we want to invite both Powers and Scanlon in, or do we want to have them submit any additional information so they're not both here publicly, you know, bidding war against each other? I think we should ask ourselves these things before we take the vote on the motion, so we know exactly what the motion means if it passes.
To clarify the motion that I seconded anyway was to postpone to a date that was definitely before our next regular meeting.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Whatever that may be.
And to that, if it's not Monday or Tuesday next week, I'm not available. I'm tied up the whole rest of the week. So if it is a Monday or Tuesday, you're not going to get me back next week.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Klein.
I'd also like to clarify, I don't feel like we need to bring in the candidates. I feel like, you know, we've heard that they're all equally suitable. It's really just a matter of making that decision about whether we want the new eyes or not, or whether we can get a good price. And so I think it would actually obfuscate things for us to be turned into some kind of interview, quasi-interview committee.
So Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Speckin.
So that would leave us, if Councilor Murphy, and I think it's important for you to be here as Chair of Finance, that would leave us to do it before the 15th. I guess it'd have to be done before the 15th. That leaves us Monday, September 14th as the only day.
Well,
I
That's right.
Councilor Murphy said he's only available Monday and Tuesday of next week. Monday's Labor Day, so it really leaves us only Tuesday.
No.
The 14th is the following week.
Just so you know, I cannot make it on Monday the 14th. I just wanted to throw that out there, and I think people are going to have different things on they trying to schedule a meeting. When we
right. I can't do Tuesday either of those weeks. So.
Yeah.
Councilor Shira?
I sort of brought this up in the beginning, and I want to bring it again sort of from Dan, which is wondering if our clerk has any opinions that she'd like to give, having learned a great deal about all this, if she has anything.
Thank you, Councilor.
Well, I don't want to give you my opinion, but I do want to give you my observations. And that is that I put together the RFP, the request for proposal, sent it out and asked for the firms to, you know, give us their interpretation of what it is that, you know, they would deliver based on the request for proposal that I sent out. I think if you're interested, you know, at all in sort of making your own observations, perhaps the best approach would be to review the RFP and just look at the two proposals that were submitted. And then perhaps you might draw your own conclusion about whether it is a good idea to have a new set of eyes or stay with the same firm.
Okay, so it seems that if the council agrees with that, I think what the council needs to do next is perhaps move on, leave scheduling to the council president, the council clerk, or decide to take the vote tonight. Councilor Carney?
I would just point out that there are 8 councilors here tonight, and it seems pretty unlikely that we're going to have a date in the before the 15th that we'll have even 8. Never mind 9 councilors. So I think that will certainly skew the vote in one direction or the other. What we have tonight is we have a supermajority. We're missing the council president, but we have certainly the most number of councilors present tonight than we will have any other night before the 15th, just given the scheduling concerns that I heard right now. And it might behoove us to go ahead and try to vote on the motion that was on the table rather than trying to postpone this to a date that will most likely not work in terms of having a critical mass of representation.
Councilor Spector.
Yeah, I don't disagree with that. And but I still haven't heard, I'd ask somewhat facetiously, what happens if we schedule this for the 17th? I understand it's in the charter, we don't. We've missed the deadline before because that's a meeting time we've all scheduled. I would hope we'd have at least 8, maybe we have 9, which is, you know, usual. But if someone can tell me that, you know, that's really not a good thing to do, it's really terrible, then I'll say I would agree with you. But I still haven't heard what happens if we vote on this on the 17th.
Well, I think my opinion is what needs to happen is we should take a vote to see if the council wants to postpone it at all, because that's the vote, that's the motion that's on the table. If the council doesn't want to postpone it, well, then we're going to take the vote tonight. If the council does want to postpone it, then we'll have to get back to that question.
But I think it's a practical question. If I knew we had a date for a special meeting and that we had at least this number, I would vote for postponing it to that date. I would like to get a chance, as Councilor Klein pointed out, there might be other negotiations in terms of the money. But if we don't have that date, so I kind of want to put out there that, again, my question, what I would vote for is to postpone it to our next council meeting. But if someone could answer the question for me, what happens if we do that? I understand it says the 15th, we've missed the deadline before. I guess, would someone like to give a crack, convince me that it's a really bad thing to do?
Can I just make an observation about the charter itself and that 15th date? It says in the charter that we need to make the something about name the auditor or have a contract in place before September 15th. It doesn't say for which fiscal years. So we're interpreting this to mean that we mean the next fiscal years, but when in fact, if you mean September 15th for last year's audit, we already have that in place. So my understanding in talking at least to one of the auditing firms is that we are way ahead of the curve, that they don't normally get these RFPs until the spring, and then their contracts are signed after that point. So honestly, if you want my opinion about something, the September 15th, objective has already been met for this year.
I'd like to make an amendment to the motion that we postpone this till the 17th, our meeting on the 17th.
Could you postpone that motion just?
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
I understand that the board makes an excellent point, and maybe it's something that we should have pointed out more clearly, is that this is for
16.
Right, it's for fiscal year
16. Yeah.
So, we're not talking about the auditor that we're using for this fiscal year.
Counselor, if I could just answer your question really quickly. I think the answer to your question is the likelihood, nothing. The possibility, someone could challenge the vote. Likelihood, nothing.
So what I'm hearing, though, is the city clerk's opinion, which is a legal opinion, is saying we're way ahead of the game, that this is, it doesn't say in the charter.
Well, it doesn't say
what fiscal year.
You have to make the decision by September 15th, but it doesn't say for which fiscal years.
Yeah.
If you're interpreting it to mean the fiscal year that just passed, we've already met that objective, and we already have a contract in place with an auditor who's starting in September.
Councilor Klein?
Yeah, I'd like to make an amendment that we vote on this at our next scheduled meeting, regularly scheduled meeting.
Do you have something to say about that?
Councilor Klein, for perspective clarification, that's the 17th.
The 17th, yeah.
Is there a second? Is there a second to Councilor Klein's motion?
Originally it was my motion. I would withdraw my original motion and allow that to be the motion.
Okay.
Councilor Klein's would become the motion.
So are you moving to postpone until September 17th?
I would second
the 17th.
Okay. Is there any further discussion on that?
I just want to make absolutely clear that the 17th of this calendar year does not put us out of compliance with the charter. I just want to be clear about that. Is that the consensus
charter,
of
you can read it yourself.
I mean, that's the kind of thing. That's why. I mean, if anyone.
I actually agree with Ms. Powers' interpretation, and I know, and the city solicitor has said that this language was not really written very well, just with the way the nature of the audits work. So, because you are usually hiring for the next fiscal year, because if your audit's not already in process for 15, you're in trouble at this point. So
you're not going to get somebody.
So oddly enough, before the charter passed, that audit, the first year of the charter had already been hired. So you were already like a year. So, I mean, it's vague language, I guess is what I'm saying. It's very vague language.
Thank you for that opinion. I guess
there's
makes sense.
Numbers and dates, but it's not clear which fiscal year you're auditing for, and we're always a year. You're always out a year ahead.
Here it is right here.
Yeah, it's on the board there.
So the contract, if I read this right, the contract to audit has already been granted for September 15th of this year.
The contract is already in place for last year's audit. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So. So then we're in compliance right now, the way that I read that, when it says for each year.
And quite honestly, because this is so new to all of us, I didn't really have a good understanding of that until, like I said, I was talking with one of the auditing firms, and they said, we don't normally get these RFPs until the spring.
Right. So theoretically, we would have a lot longer, even than September 17th, to plan this. We could give ourselves another few months to get all
until
the data
next
and get
September.
More information and really mull it over.
Yes.
I mean, if we really, it doesn't seem as though there's any rush to get get ourselves 363 days, you know, jump on what might be the requirement for next year.
Councilor Murphy?
Although, to the point, if it was for 15, we'd have a heck of a time finding an auditor at this point to do the fiscal year that just ended.
Right. I wouldn't say wait. I wouldn't say wait 12 months, but we could give ourselves another month. We don't have to even try to push ourselves to make this decision in 2 weeks. We could give ourselves the time to.
It is unusual that the charter says that, but we did our best to get it here for you tonight. The one thing I'd ask is, if you're in favor of this motion, you want to kick the can till 2 weeks from now. You know, think of what you're going to do to be more prepared 2 weeks from now than you are now. Because that's what we're saying, is we can't make a decision tonight because there's something really meaningful we're going to, you know, develop to understand this question better 2 weeks from now.
Mr. Mayor?
If it made a councilor feel more comfortable, I could ask the city solicitor to just give the council a brief opinion on this.
If I may, I think that would be worthwhile. And for the purpose of the motion, I mean, if the motion could just be postponed to the next regular or special meeting, that would cover us. And then if in theory we had to call a special meeting, which practically we won't do, that would be an ideal motion. So
I'll rephrase the motion that I suggest that we postpone our decision till to our next meeting or a special meeting. Is that?
Second. Okay. Is there any further discussion on that? Councilor Klein, Councilor Murphy.
Just about the process, because I hear Councilor Murphy saying a couple times already, what are you all going to do to prepare yourselves? But I would like us to understand what pieces of information we still need and how we're in fact going to get them. And can we rely on the Finance Committee to do that for us and bring us the answers? Can we ask the clerk to do it? What are we going to do to get the information we need?
I'm happy to send you the report that I did just on the observations regarding the RFP. It was just a snapshot of what the process was, how the firms measured up against what we asked them to do for us, and then I think the Finance Committee used that to some degree. I can send you that. I can send you the copy of the, the RFPs if you want to read them. I think that, you know, my report sort of didn't include any opinions, but I'm certainly happy to give you them.
I think that would be greatly appreciated. I know that I speak for myself, but seems to be consensus. Councilor Murphy, Councilor Sherrod.
I want to say that I'm not going to vote to extend simply because if a special meeting pops up, the odds are very good I wouldn't be able to be here. So if you do go with a special meeting, I'm unlikely to be able to be here given my schedule next week.
Councilor Scheer.
I'm not sure of anything yet. Other than that, I think the clerk's being modest about her report. It's very comprehensive, and I think it'll be very helpful for everyone to read that and maybe the proposals that came in.
Councilor Donald.
If I can just, you know, first to Councilor Murphy, I think it's also unlikely we would have a special meeting. I think it's more likely we'll just go to the regular meeting. And I would also say, in summary, I think what you're seeing here, which is a very messy process, to just be perfectly honest, is us struggling with something new. And I don't think that's at all unhealthy, to be quite honest with you. I think that's okay. And I think that this is something we're experimenting with, and it's okay to take some time, especially if we have the time. And it's a contract for 3 years. So just to be clear, a motion to postpone, in my opinion, is not in any way an indictment on the excellent work the Finance Committee has done, on the excellent work the clerk has done. And I'll underscore that, back up what Councilor Sherrod did about our council clerk, and thank her as well. It's just that we have to take time, in my opinion, to consider it carefully, and that's all it is. So,
is there any further discussion on the motion to postpone till the next regular or special meeting? Councilor Klein?
I feel like we still haven't come up with a process here of how, I mean, I again, the 2 points, I feel like I'm a broken record, and I'm sorry for that. The 2 points that I really want to hear about are a negotiated price from Powers, and if we can find any information about how other cities have used other eyes, if they've stayed consistently, or if there are any recommendations from the Department of Revenue or anything else along those lines.
I was just it's incumbent upon us to research what we need and bring it to the next meeting.
We can just research and share with ourselves.
Yeah, exactly.
The negotiated price is something that can't. Yeah.
Part of the process that I think Councilor Murphy had asked me to do was to do some reference checks. And I can send you a list of the questions that I asked and some of the feedback that I got, which included, you know, what do you think about staying with the same firm? Have you changed auditors yourself? So we have a snapshot of at least one reference check per firm that may give you some, you know, indication. But and their proposals also, you know, do have references in them if you wanted to check them yourself.
Yeah, it's not a question so much about the firms themselves. I think it's more kind of just process around the question of the, you know, whether or not other cities, other municipalities change their audit or not.
That's in there. I have some information about that.
But from the perspective of the auditor companies, right?
No, these are reference checks that I did. I called the cities that they said that they bought it and asked them questions.
Okay,
yeah, these are definitely not the auditors giving me information.
And I would definitely request, if we're going to let one firm change the bid amount, you know, if we're going to say, hey, we got two finalists, if you're going to let one change the bid amount, you got to go to the other and say, hey, you know, resubmit, or, you know, and have a process for that, because you can't say, well, they said this might not be their bottom line, but never go to the other company and give them an opportunity to change their bid amount if they wish to. So if that's what your thoughts are, and that's going to be part of the process, I think that has to be extended to both companies that are finalists if we want to do that.
Is there any further discussion on this matter? Roll call vote, please.
Councilor Klein?
Are we voting on the motion to postpone
this? Yes.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
No.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Scherer?
Yes.
Councilor Spector?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
No.
Councilor Carney?
No.
Motion passes. Next, we'll move to...
Oh, just to clarify, again, that motion was to the 17th or a special meeting?
That's right.
So what will determine whether or not it will be a special meeting?
I believe if the solicitor
says
tells us that the interpretation is that we have to have it done by the 15th, we're going to have a special meeting. If we don't have to have it done by the 15th, we're going to do it at a regular meeting on the 17th.
Okay.
So next we'll move to 10B, which is minutes of committees. And we have the Public Works Committee of the City Council meeting of June 29th, 2015, and the minutes of the Finance Committee meetings of July 28th and August 13th, 2015. Is there a motion to accept these as a group?
Second.
It.
Is there any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Abstentions? Next, we'll move to 10C, which is appointments to committees. Refer to the committee rules, orders, appointments, and ordinances. These are all referrals, I believe. So
take them as a group.
If we can take if the council has no objection, I'd like to take all of them as a group.
Be great.
And
make that motion.
Second.
Is there any further discussion on this matter? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? There are no financial orders. Now we will move to number 12 on the agenda, which is orders and ordinances. A is 15.473, the administrative order to consolidate the offices of the treasurer and the offices of the office of the collector, and this is on second reading.
Move second reading.
Second.
Is there any further discussion on this matter? Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Motion passes. Next, we'll move to ordinance 15.463, the ordinance to specify parking limits on North Maple Street in Florence, and this is the second reading. Is there a motion
to approve?
Second.
Is there any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Motion passes. If it pleases the council, I'd like to move C and D referral to the group.
So moved.
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
Word for referral.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Are there any updates from committee chairs? Are there any information requests pursuant to 14? Is there any new business?
I have some new business to present to the council, which I'm passing around. This is a proposal for some revisions to our council rules for the next session. And it's not something that we're going to deliberate on tonight, obviously, but the end of the second year of this session is a good time to bring up the subject, and I wanted to distribute the proposal to all the councils for their opinions, because in the development of this, I wasn't able to discuss them with you because of the open meetings law, one-on-one, of course. So I bring it to you tonight for consideration at a future meeting.
And just to clarify, I believe Councilor O'Donnell and Councilor Dwight, the other sponsor, are requesting and accepting comments and questions.
To the extent we can, outside of open session.
Just to, for submission and not discussion.
Just a process question.
Well,
Is the document here, is it highlighted where the changes are? Because I would imagine much of this is already in our, is there a way to have this so that those changes you brought up could be highlighted?
I can provide that to you, Councilor. After a certain point, there were so many changes, I just accepted them all, so.
Okay.
I will, through the council clerk, will provide information electronically.
Great, thank you. Thank you.
Is there any other new business? Is there a motion to adjourn?
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you.